I just found out from security, do not shoot the messenger. This is just, I'm just relaying the message from security. There are two vehicles that are parked in places where they cannot remain. One is a dark blue Pontiac G6, license number EIP3237. The other is a silver Dodge truck, AFW3129. I'm just passing along the message. Security says they need to be moved. Also, if you're looking for John Butchko, he will be here this afternoon. He's doing a memorial service this morning in Westlake. Just a few brief words about the communion service today in particular, just so everybody knows how this is going to work. There are 26 serving stations that will be spread throughout the auditorium at the time that we serve communion. We will be receiving communion by the method of intinction, which means you take a piece of bread, dip it into the cup, and consume both elements at the same time. And there would be one additional station that that is not spread throughout the auditorium. There is a gluten and dairy-free bread station, thanks to Jim Lewis. And Jim, I'm going to ask that you would serve those folks down here. So if you have allergy issues and need gluten and dairy-free bread, it will be right down here, and you can come to that station at the appropriate time. For the rest of us, the stations will be to your right, to the aisle to your right. So what will happen is that the servers will come around and you will stand two rows at a time. This is exactly the same as we've done it as long as I can remember. So if you've been around, you can go to sleep during this part of the instruction. Two rows will stand. The first row will move to your right to the communion servers and receive the elements. The second row will actually move to your left. You'll go to the end of that row and then come into the front row. And everybody kind of makes a big circle at that point to come back around and receive the elements. And eventually you'll come back to your chairs where you started from and be seated again. There are also two serving stations in the back for those who are serving the conference at other capacities who don't have a seat in the auditorium. There'll be a station at either side, so whatever is more convenient for you to go to, you can do that. I think that's all that I need to tell you. It is going to be a wonderful week of worshiping together. We'll see how the business goes, but at least I know the worship is going to be wonderful. It is great to see all of you here, and let us prepare to encounter God as we center ourselves.
In this season of Pentecost, I welcome you to Lakeside and to the 42nd session of the East Ohio Annual Conference. We gather on this lakeshore, as Methodists have done for 140 years, to praise God, to receive the Holy Spirit, and to be renewed and filled through the Word and the Sacrament. I officially call the East Ohio Annual Conference to order and ask you to stand as we sing, "And Are We Yet Alive?"
Good morning. Let us pray. God, our Creator, fill us with your presence today. As we gather to worship, expand our capacity to love you and all your children. As we remember gratefully those who have gone before us, draw us closer to each other and quiet our restless hearts. Strengthen us and empower us to share your love with those who need it most. Guide us in all that we do, that we may truly be the body of Christ in the world. Amen.
As we remember the ministries of these men and women of God, we shall read their names aloud and light individual candles to celebrate their lives on earth, now and in heaven. In loving memory, giving thanks to God, we celebrate these faithful servants of Jesus Christ, who now rest from their labors in God's eternal realm. Please. We give you thanks for one who served as an Episcopal leader of the Anhangel Conference.
Bishop James Samuel Thomas.
God of all saints, we give thanks for those ordained, consecrated, and licensed in this annual conference. Gail O. Bergstresser. Herbert R. Bundy. Paul A. Clark. Stanley G. Coate. Arthur Deutsch. Robert R. Dietrich, Jr. Chauncey L. Egan. Charles E. Frost. D. Scott George. Philip Gillis. Robert J. Hahn. Robert C. John Cox. John Johnson. H. Dean McElroy. Frank A. McMillan, Jr. David A. Porter. Daniel R. Romali. Leroy C. Rubel. Gilbert Schilling. George E. Thompson. Frank L. Tully. William A. Urey. Enzi B. Wade. Clyde Willis. Ivan Melville Worley. David Yost.
God of all saints, we give thanks for spouses who shared their ministry in this annual conference. Evelyn Evie Althaus. Anne Benedict. Peggy Jean Butler. Juliet Krabs. Ruth E. Deutsch. Dorothy L. Fulmer. Florence Hubbard. Sandy Humphreys. Christine Kirk. Jane Lockard. Delana Opplinger. Esther Plyler. Virginia Pocock. Myrtle Alice Riley. Naomi Snowfall. Margaret Peg Snyder. George David Spiker. Gladys B. Strawn. Mary Tilson. Ellen Wheeler. Claudia Willis.
God of all saints, we give thanks for the ministry of the laity, those who have led faithfully in this annual conference. Carol Blair. Penny K. Hetch. Ray Ketchum. Marjorie Edgar Marling. Daniel McMullen. Carrie L. Pickett. Lydia Smith.
God of all saints, we give thanks for children, siblings, and loved ones whom we now name in our hearts before you. Eternal God, you see face to face those we remember here. Tell them that we love them, that we miss them, that they are not forgotten, and cheered by the prospect of a day when there will be no more death or parting, and all shall be well, and all shall be one. May they whom we remember be among the first to welcome us to heaven. Until that day, when we share in the everlasting feast of Christ's family, keep us in faith, fill us with hope, deepen our connections through love, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
earth over.
As we focus this week on the theme, if we are the body of Christ, with emphasis on that word, if, please listen to these words of the Apostle Paul. After Paul enumerates a number of gifts of the Spirit, he goes down to verse 11 of chapter 12. And I know you've heard this many times before, but please listen again as we use the Message paraphrase. Find yourself in the story. All these gifts have a common origin, but are all handed out by the one and only Spirit of God. He decides who gets what and when. You can easily see enough how this kind of thing works by looking no further than your own body. Your body has many parts, limbs, organs, cells, but no matter how many parts you can name, you are still one body. It's exactly that way with Christ. By means of his one Spirit, we all said goodbye to our partial and piecemeal lives. We each used to independently call our own shots, but then we entered into a large and integrated life in which he has a final say in everything. This is what we proclaim in word and action when we were baptized. Each of us is now a part of the resurrection body, refreshed and sustained at one fountain, his Spirit, where we all come to drink. The old labels once used to identify ourselves, labels like Jew and Greek, free and slave, are no longer useful. We need something larger, something more comprehensive. I want you to think about how all this makes you more significant, not less so. A body isn't just a single part blown up into something huge. It's all the different but similar parts arranged and functioning together. If the foot said, "I'm not elegant like hand, embellished with rings, I guess I don't belong to this body," would that make it so? If ear said, "I'm not beautiful like eye, limpid and expressive, I don't deserve a place on the head," would you want to remove it from the body? If the body was all eye, how would it hear? If all ear, how would it smell? As it is, we see that God has carefully placed each part of the body right where he wanted it. But I also want you to think about how this keeps your significance from getting blown up into self-importance. For no matter how significant you are, it is only because of what you are a part of. As an enormous eye or a gigantic head would not be a body, but a monster. What we have is one body with many parts. Each is proper size and in its proper place. No place is important on its own. Can you imagine eye telling hand, get lost, I don't need you? Or head telling foot, you're fired? Your job has been phased out? As a matter of fact, in practice, it works just the other way. The lower the part, the more basic, and therefore necessary. You can live without an eye, for instance, but not without a stomach. When it's a part of your own body you are concerned with, it makes no difference whether the part is visible, clothed, higher or lower. Visible or clothed, higher or lower. You give it dignity and honor just as it is without comparisons. If anything, you have more concern for the lower parts than for the higher. If you had to choose, would you prefer good digestion to a full body hair? The way God designed our bodies is a model for understanding our lives together as a church. Every part dependent on every other part, the parts we mention and the parts we don't, the parts we see and the parts we don't. If one part hurts, every other part is involved in the hurt and in the healing. If one part flourishes, every other part enters into exuberance. You are Christ's body. That's what you are. You must never forget this. Thanks be to God for his holy word. Amen.
Good morning, church. Good morning, holy-filled, Holy Spirit-filled, fired up and ready to worship and praise God, church. Good morning, church, born in diversity, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and sent to be witnesses of Jesus Christ in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and all the ends of the earth. Good morning, church. As small as two or three people gathered together in the name of Jesus, and as large as all who would worship at the foot of the cross and celebrate the Eucharist and affirm Jesus as Lord. Isn't it good to be back in Hoover? Last year, if you remember, we had an incredible experience here when Dave Sperry, one of our pastors, came and gave a testimony about how he was facing liver cancer, and in working up for the liver cancer surgery, they discovered he had colon cancer. Remember that? Well, he's back. Dave, are you in the house today? Where is David? Where is he? He's back in the back over here. David, we just want to say we're glad you're back. He's not out of the cancer woods yet. He's still got some struggles, but his doctors have said he can start preaching in July, and he's a happy camper. I've actually assigned him an appointment. God is good. It's all. But I got you guys are fired up with this spirit. I don't know. You're not responding at the points that I've marked here. You're ahead of me. You're ahead of me. I just want to say, when I come back into this place, I just feel like I'm in sacred space and time. Isn't it wonderful to be back here? You know, if these walls could talk. If we could hear the holy hum of Hoover, that has taken place over the last 100 and so many years, who knows how long this place has been here. Wow. We wouldn't worry about the future, we'd be the church. We wouldn't worry about what we can do, we'd worry about what God is going to do through us. It's just wonderful to be back here. Bishop Marion Edwards, one of my colleagues, died this past January. He served in North Carolina and actually grew up in South Georgia. He told the story about walking through the backwoods of South Georgia one day and came along a fence, and he was walking along. He looked on top of one of the fence posts, and there was a little turtle sitting on the top of that fence post. He scratched his head, and he said, "Now, that turtle didn't get there by itself." And neither did we. We stand on the shoulders of people who have worshiped here and have struggled with all kinds of adversity and found strength in Christ in this place. And so when we gather together as the East Ohio Annual Conference, there is a vibrancy, a foundation that we cannot imagine. And so we're not alone today. No, we're not alone. The Holy Spirit is with us, and we stand on the shoulders of giants. When the Council of Bishops met just about a month ago at Epworth-by-the-Sea on St. Simon's Island, we had a memorial service for all of the bishops and spouses who had died in the previous year. You may not be aware of this, but you know, when a pastor is ordained, they leave their local church membership and they have their membership in an annual conference. But when a bishop is consecrated, they move their membership from an annual conference to the Council of Bishops. And so twice a year when the council gathers, we have a memorial service. In addition to Bishop Edwards that was honored, there are some other people there that you may remember. We honored Alice Kearns, the wife of Bishop Francis Kern, who is beloved in this area, who died on March 15th at 100 years old. We also remembered Louise Duffy, who is Bishop Paul Duffy's wife, who served in the Alabama area, and she actually went to high school with my mother at Sidney Lanier High School. We remembered Anna Marie DeWitt. Jess DeWitt was a bishop in this jurisdiction that served in Wisconsin and Northern Illinois. We remembered Ray Owen, whose brother is a member of Church of the Savior in Cleveland Heights. Bill Dew, who served in Portland, Oregon and Phoenix, Arizona. And Edsel Ammons, who was the bishop who served in Michigan and West Ohio in this jurisdiction. We remembered Bishop James K. Matthews, who was a former missionary to India, a personal friend of Gandhi's, and was married to Eunice, the daughter of E. Stanley Jones. And he served in 4 different Episcopal areas, including Zimbabwe. And of course, we remembered our beloved Bishop James S. Thomas, who died on October the 10th, 2010, who served Iowa and the East Ohio area. Many of you were able to participate in the wonderful service we had at North Canton Faith Service or Church, and we were honored with Ruth's presence, and Bishop Palmer brought a message that we will not soon forget. Bishop Thomas left this conference a legacy of Christian strength and humility that still defines East Ohio. He was a man of faith, of discipline, of scholarship, of humor, and of dedication. When I was elected bishop in 1996, Bishop Thomas and Ruth became mentors for Elaine and I, and we had many great memories together at the Council of Bishops and at other gatherings. I remember about 2 years after I was elected bishop, after we had gotten pretty well acquainted, we were in a hotel in Des Moines, Iowa, where the Council of Bishops was meeting. We had a meal with the Thomases, and we're sitting at the meal, and Bishop Thomas always took the conversation, would turn it to something more serious. And so he looked at me and he said, "John," he said, "I've been reading about this internet, and I noticed that you have a lot of gadgets. Can you tell me what this internet is and how it works?" And then I learned that they had a computer and that Ruth had already been playing games on the computer, but they had not learned to use email yet and had never done anything on the internet. So Elaine had her laptop computer with her, and she said, "Yeah, we'll be happy. We'll come up to your room." So as soon as we finished the meal, about 30 minutes later, we took the laptop up to the Thomas's room. And in this hotel room in Des Moines, Iowa, we got online, and He said, well, the way this works is you put in the name of something and you do a search. Back then, we didn't have Google. I think it was Excite was the name of the search engine. Some of you may remember that. So I said, let me just show you. I don't know if there's anything out there, but let me just type in Bishop James S. Thomas. Well, I typed in his name and things were slow. It was a dial-up then, I think. And we waited, and all of a sudden, a picture of Bishop Thomas shows up and about 20 articles below it. And he just did that humor. He said, oh, John. And his face lit up with a sense of joy. And I thought I had given a little child candy for the first time. Even at his age, he was a learner and he was excited. And so they went on to do email. And even when I see Ruth today, she says, I'm getting back to my email. I need to have somebody come over and do something with my computer. Everywhere I go, I find his footprints because we stand on the shoulders of giants. I was at a meeting just less than 4 weeks ago, and I said, I'm really looking forward to East Ohio Conference because since I've been there, it seems like it's such a sweet conference. I know other conferences, it seems like they're always wrangling and there's kind of an ugliness or something. And Laura Root, who's a member of that committee, she said, that's because Bishop Thomas taught us how to behave as a conference. I said, what do you mean? She said, well, when we got kind of ugly, he would come into that special tone that he had and that sincerity, and he'd lean forward and said, that's not the church. You shouldn't applaud at things, and would calm people down. And she said, you don't know it, but I'm inheriting a legacy of a sweet annual conference because of the ministry of Bishop Thomas. For what he said and how he lived both reflected the love of God. Bishop Thomas is somebody who had balance in his life. And when you were with him, you felt that balance because he was connected to God and could connect with you. I have trouble finding balance in my life between taking care of my needs and taking care of the needs of a world with many people who are in poverty, who are struggling. I have trouble taking care of my own personal health. You know, to take care of your own health, you've got to have a balance between your mind, your body, and your spirit. If you're not stimulating your mind, if you're not taking care of your body, and if you're not caring for your spirit, something's wrong. And for me, I don't know about you, but I can usually get two of those right. But it's really hard to keep all three together at the same time. The same is true for the church that's true for us personally. On Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came to those who followed Jesus, and they were unified, they were empowered, and they were sent on a mission. And with the power of the Holy Spirit, with the power that wasn't theirs, they could do things that they could not do on their own. The church is always faithful when it's unified, when it's empowered, and when it's on a mission. Now, the church needs all three, and often we get two, but we can't get all three. The church, if it's unified but has no power or mission, it won't work. If it has power but no unity and it's not clear on its mission, it's not going to work. And if we have a mission, but we don't have any unity or we don't have any power, it's not going to work either. And so the church over the years has always tried to find a balance of unity and power and mission. And that only comes by being close to God in the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, the church at Corinth was having problems. They were divided into factions. Some thought their spiritual gifts were better than others. Some thought that the more spectacular gifts, like healing and prophecy, were more important than some of the lesser or dramatic gifts. We don't have those problems today. We think all of our churches are equal. All of our people are acceptable. All denominations are the same. When God looks at American Christianity, God must just weep at the way we have fragmented the body of Christ. And even among United Methodists, sometimes your bishop weeps because churches become so enclosed in themselves that they don't realize that we're a family of churches. So Paul sends them a letter, first letter to the Corinthians, and he shares his idea that the church is like a body. The body of Christ is the image that he takes, and he gets this image from the doctrines out of Stoicism, which was probably the most popular type of philosophy in the Mediterranean world at his time. You see, the Stoics thought of the whole world as a single community or a single state, and they described the community as a body with every person being a limb of that body. So Paul takes this doctrine, but then he does much more of it when he talks about the body of Christ. He says that the church is not only similar to a body, it actually is Christ's body. This is more of a Jewish concept where a group of people like a family take on a single personality. And so he doesn't say we are like a body. He says we are the body of Christ. Christ and his followers are to be like one person. If you are baptized, you are no longer able to live as yourself, but as part of a larger body. Jesus Christ, through the Holy Spirit, takes up residence in us as an individual and as a church. His actions become our actions. And listen to this. As a result of the Holy Spirit, God's active work in us, some miraculous way, produces activity that resembles Christ somewhat, so that people look at us and they can see Christ. And they would never see that with our own power. But as we become one, and we have the power and we have the mission, God sees in us the very presence of Christ. For together the church extends the heart and mind, the eyes and the ears, the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. Every Christian is a necessary member of the community. Every Christian needs the help of every other Christian, whether we think it or not. And particular respect should be shown to those members of the community who appear to be less important or marginalized than the rest of us. If one suffers, all suffer. If one is honored, all rejoice together. Each of us have experiences of the unity, the power, and the mission of the church in different ways. And one of the reasons we come to an annual conference is to share our experience of the church. Not that we can see that that's primary for everybody, but we share what we've experienced and other people share what they've experienced. And it's like the loaves and the fishes. We are able to increase and reach multitudes when we each share our experience of the body of Christ. Let me tell you one of my stories. This past January, 2011, I was in Houston, Texas. I thought it was going to be fairly warm in Texas in January, but it wasn't. It was a little chilly. I went there because the Association of Directors of Council on Ministries, that means Paul White and all of his cronies, were having a national meeting, and they wanted to hear something about the call to action, and so I was tabbed to go down there and speak to all of these church bureaucrats. I'm sorry, Paul, I mean servants of the Lord. Well, the hotel was about 10 blocks away from St. John's Church. Now, if you know anything about St. John's, that's where Rudy and Juanita Rasmus are. It's in a poor section. It's an incredible hopping church. And so we walked the 8 or 10 blocks as a group over and back the first day. But the next morning, I had a phone call conference I had to be on, and I had to be over there to make the presentation a certain time, so I ended up walking alone. I left a little late. It was a little chilly. I didn't have a top coat on, and so I'm kind of hustling these 8 or 10 blocks. Well, when you get closer to that church, you have to cut over a side street, and it goes under an underpass, kind of it's a road over it or something, just about one block before you get to St. John's Church, and there's security people around at the church so that you can come in one door and so forth. Well, I was late. I had my briefcase with me, and I kind of felt strange walking through that neighborhood and under this underpass. And so I crossed over the street, and at the underpass, there was this man kind of huddled down. He looked old, but as I think about it, he was probably my age. You know, that says a lot the way we judge people by the way they look. So he was kind of huddled down a little bit, and I walked by and I said, you know, John, a bishop shouldn't be walking so fast they can't greet people on the street. So I said to him, I said, good morning. He said, good morning. I said, well, it's a little chilly here. I said, you know, I was expecting Houston to be warm, just small talk. And he responded, he said, yeah, it's a little chilly today. And so I stopped. I said, that'd be kind of, you know, just slow down, John. I had to catch my breath anyway. So I said, yeah, I came down from Cleveland and I expected to be kind of warm in Houston, so I didn't bring a top coat or anything. I said, you got a pretty nice coat on. He said, yeah, it had kind of a heavy windbreaker kind of thing, kind of a royal blue. He said, yeah, I just got this. He said, it really is pretty nice. And I said, that's going to keep you warm. He said, here, why don't you take it? You know, I didn't laugh when he said that. I felt part of the body of Christ. It humbled this bishop that a man hunched over in an underpass in Houston, Texas, had never met me before, two blocks from Rudy's church, said, "You can have my coat." He had just had it a couple weeks because he was saying how nice it was or something. But he said, "You can," and he meant it. And I said, "Oh, no, I'm just have a short time." And said, "Have a good day," and walked on. But I'll never be the same because this man offered me his coat. That's what it meant to experience the body of Christ for me. How have you experienced the body of Christ? Let me invite somebody out here that can tell you how they've experienced the body of Christ this year. Would Kurt and Michelle Bissell, one of our pastors and family, come out? Will you tell your story?
Thanks, Bishop. This is my wife, Michelle, and son, Caleb, who's 20 months old, and he's been a little rowdy back there, so you'll have to bear with us. Our journey began November 1st, 2010, as Michelle and I went for the routine ultrasound of our second child. Instead of being filled with the joys of pregnancy, we were informed that our son had a heart condition. A few days later, we went to the cardiologist at Akron Children's Hospital, who diagnosed our son with a serious but treatable heart condition called tetralogy of Fallot, otherwise known as TOF. With a 95% success surgery rate, the news was not good, but it was not wholly discouraging either. It was at this point we named him Jude Jeffrey so that people could pray for him by name. We chose Jude for several reasons, one of which is that the Saint Jude is the patron saint of lost causes and desperate situations. At that point, we didn't know exactly how desperate Jude's situation was. On December 17th, we returned to Akron Children's Hospital to do another fetal echocardiogram, and a new doctor altered the diagnosis to the rarest and most serious form of TOF. The complexities of the new diagnosis presented potentially life-threatening complications that wouldn't be fully known until birth. At this appointment, just a week before Christmas, we were told that Jude had a 10% chance of survival. After a tearful Christmas, we made the decision to deliver Jude at the University of Michigan Medical Center because of their expertise in pediatric heart surgery. As a scheduled induction date approached, our SBRC at Brimfield Faith United Methodist Church, with the guidance of our district superintendent, Reverend Valerie Stoltz, arranged for me to take a full 6 weeks of paternity leave. We ended up needing and using every day of that leave. On Sunday, March 6th, before leaving for Michigan, our congregation lovingly gathered around Michelle, Caleb, and I, presented us with a generous love offering, laid hands on us, and prayed for us. They hugged and they cried with us as we prepared to go up to Michigan. Inviting the congregation and the entire conference into our journey was a difficult one, but it's one that I'm glad and that I'm grateful that we did, because it allowed for us to experience the church being the church, embracing, loving, and praying. On March 15th at 1:16 a.m., Jude Jeffrey Bissell was born. Jude's health quickly took a somewhat unexpected turn for the worst, as they were unable to stabilize his oxygen saturation levels. By 4 a.m. that morning, we were informed that he would be needed to be placed on a heart and lung bypass machine called ECMO in attempts to stabilize him. At 4:30 in the morning, I called my good friend, Reverend Dave Scavuzzo, and asked him to come to Michigan, a three-hour drive, to baptize our baby. Dave said he would be there that evening, and even as I apologized for waking him up so early, he said, "Oh no, I've been up. I'm making coffee right now. I've been thinking about you all morning." That afternoon, my associate, Reverend Tom Paremba, and a congregation member unexpectedly showed up to pray with us and to support us. They only stayed a short while, but it was a meaningful and timely visit. Shortly after they left, Around 12 hours after our son's birth, Michelle and I consulted with the doctors. After that discussion, we made a decision to remove baby Jude from life support that evening and to forego any other treatment. At 10:30 that evening, Dave arrived from Cleveland to minister to us, to hug us, to cry with us, and to baptize our precious baby boy. After unhooking him from life support, Jude died peacefully in his mother's arms on March 16th at 2:28 a.m. We have experienced the body of Christ in so many tangible ways over the last 8 months. At Jude's memorial service, Brimfield Faith, my church, organized food for over 300. This is a church that averages less than 100 in worship. The Kent United Methodist Church generously donated their facilities and helped with the service. And hundreds of friends, family, and fellow clergy came out to support me and my family as we grieve the loss of our son. Afterwards, the meals arrived, the cards poured in, and the love overflowed. None of it will bring back our precious baby boy, but it certainly brought peace and comfort in our most trying of times. Our journey of grief is not over. In many ways, it's just begun. It will be 3 months ago on Thursday that Jude died. When people ask how we're doing, the most honest answer we can give is that we're still grieving. The 25 hours we had with Jude were simply too short. We grieve what should have been, what could have been of his life. Some days are easier than others, but many days are just plain awful. If I could end with one thought to you as the body of Christ, it would be this. Remember that you are always the body of Christ. You are always God's presence in the world. Remember to be the body in the time of crisis, before the crisis, during the crisis, and most importantly, after the crisis. The hardest thing for us over the last 8 months has been to see God's presence. While I fully believe what the scriptures teach us, that God will never leave us or forsake us, you know what? There are many days, if I'm really honest with you all, that it doesn't feel that way. And it's on those days that the body of Christ is so important. A hug, a card, a meal, an act of kindness, a word of encouragement becomes the presence of Christ. There are many people in your congregations on similar journeys who feel alone, abandoned by God, and desperate for love, and perhaps most importantly, for hope. God is calling you, East Ohio, to be the body of Christ, to be a healing presence in the lives of many. On the screen right now is a picture of our beloved son. And that doesn't have the website on it, but there's a website on Caring Bridge. If you type his name in, Jude Jeffrey, there it is. You can hear the rest of the story. The bishop only gave me 3 minutes, so. But Michelle is an accomplished writer, and she kind of recorded our journey. And so I would invite you to go on and to read the details of the journey. But at this time, I just want to thank you, East Ohio, for being the body of Christ in our deepest time of need. May you continue to be the body of Christ in a broken and hurting world. The world needs us. The world needs you. And Bishop, I want to thank you personally for your support and your leadership and for your kind words through this process. We might not be standing up here this morning if it wasn't for you and for many close friends who time does not allow me to list. But we thank you for your leadership, and we thank you, East Ohio. And now, in memory of our son, Jude Jeffrey, we would like to place the rose on the altar.
Let's express appreciation for the testimony of this wonderful family. Thank you. We can't be the body of Christ until we've experienced that body of Christ ourselves. And it's grace upon grace upon grace that we've all received. And only when we've received that grace can we reflect it to other people. When we realize that the Holy Spirit gives us the power to do things that we could never do by ourselves, that fortifies us to be bold as we care for those people outside of our community and those in our community. One more testimony. I would invite Jay Outhouse to come out and tell you a little bit about how he's experienced the body of Christ here in East Ohio.
In May of 1949, at age 11, I was baptized and received into membership at Winona Methodist Church, before the days of United Methodist Church, just south of Salem. I did not know it then, but in later years, I would come to know more fully how this was indeed the body of Christ receiving me in a most special way. And then what an affirmation of the body of Christ when on this stage at annual conference in June 1965, I was ordained elder by Bishop Kearns. The body of Christ was so very present when in 1968, 1,000 troops gathered for an Easter sunrise service in Benoit, Vietnam, where I served as U.S. Army chaplain. And during that same year, the pastors, spouses, and lay folk of this conference made the body of Christ known in such a special way as they cared for Evie and Kay. So many times Evie was involved with the UMW and with the conference safe sanctuary policies. She would comment on being a part of the body of Christ. Since retirement, I have experienced the body of Christ helping folks find their wholeness and well-being in the midst of conflict transformation. And as all of us, as families of those being commemorated in this service know, in such a special way, unique to each family, the body of Christ sustains us, upholds us, cares for us, and makes boundless grace known to us. Thank you, East Ohio, for your part of being the body of Christ. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for making known to us the body of Christ in ever so many ways. Amen.
How have you experienced the body of Christ? How will we experience the body of Christ this week here at Lakeside? It depends how connected we are, how much respect we pay for every member of this community, whether we're unified, whether we're empowered, and whether we have a mission we share together. As we gather around the table of our Lord this morning, remember we all kneel at the foot of the cross, and it's only by His grace that we consider ourselves part of this wonderful body. Let us pray. Each of us, O Lord, has a story to tell about your grace, about struggle and victory, victory that's not complete yet, but it's already been declared a victory because you came in Jesus Christ to take away our sins and our fear of death and set us free to serve you as part of this wonderful body. As we gather at the table today, let us be united. Let us be empowered. And send us on a mission to all the world. In Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Christ and our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Remembrance of me, eat this bread. In remembrance of me, drink this wine. In remembrance of me, pray for the time when God's own will is done. In remembrance of me, heal the sick. In remembrance of me, feed the poor. In remembrance of me, open the door and let your neighbors in. Let them in. Take, eat, and be comforted. Drink and remember too. That this is my body and precious blood shed for you, shed for you. In remembrance of me, search for truth. In remembrance of me, always love. In remembrance of me.
Would you join with me in the great thanksgiving? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Earth are
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and Holy Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen, amen.
Amen,
amen.
Amen.
And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Because there is one loaf, those who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. The bread which we break is a sharing of the body of Christ. The cup over which we give thanks is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Thanks be to God.
Draw us power, your will forever, your love is a river, yeah, overflowing me. Your word, true presence, your body, our recompense, your blood is salvation, overflowing me, overflowing me, my Lord, overflowing me, my Lord. Let your people bless you as your cup is poured.
Overflow in me, my
always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. I will not forget all your benefits, even when the storms surround my soul. How you comfort me, you heal all my diseases. How you lift me up on eagle's wings. And I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. I will not forget all your benefits, how you've chosen and adopted me. Orphaned by my sin, your grace has let me in. And never once have you abandoned me. And I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. I have tasted and I've seen how you father faithfully, how you shepherd those who fear your name. And when the shadows start to fall and my heart begins to fail, I will lift my eyes to you again. And I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. Yeah, I will remember you, always remember you. I will remember you and all you've done for me. grace that burns in me when I see you and you see me, oh Lord. On you I meditate, and as I think, my soul it faints for you. See the blaze that burns in me when I see you and you look at me, oh Lord. You are my drink, you are my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king. You are my drink, you are my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king. See the blaze that burns in me when I see you and you look at me, oh Lord. On you I meditate, and as I think, my soul it faints for you. See the blaze that burns in me when I see you and you look at me, oh Lord. You are my drink, you are my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king. You are my drink, you are my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king. Your body and your blood, and I remember you. Upon the cross you hung, and I remember you. You are the body, and I remember you. Let us be the body, so we remember you. You are my drink, you are my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king. You are my drink, my feast, you are my love, my soul's own king.
Would you join me in the closing prayer? Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
To pursue.
This then is the task that God has assigned to us, to carry the light of Christ out into the world so that all of God's children may know true love, healing, grace, and peace. May God bless us as we go forth to do His work. In Christ's name, amen.